Good day, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. My name is Helenique Ogeru, and I will be interviewing a wonderful lady called Samia Kamara today for Women of Truth. Now, most of these interviews, if you've been watching them, are really to do with the personal power that we have as individuals, and specifically as women, and the journey we take to arrive into that power. And often it encounters many different life-challenging moments, personal intuition, personality, all kinds of different aspects that we investigate with our guests. And as I just told you, Samia Kamara is now joining us as our guest today. She's a global HR director, a strategic advisor to executives for talent management, and she's based in Islamabad, GPO, Federal Capital, and AJK, Pakistan. And I'm so excited to have her here. We've become friends in the quarantine time of COVID-19, but we met just before that in Egypt at one of the Women's Economic Forum annual meetings, the first one outside of India. And it was really a very fortuitous special event because we bumped into each other literally, and I asked her to take a photo for myself and a good friend, Viola Edward. And here we are today, months later, after having collaborated, really connecting online and doing great projects together. Now, Samia, it's an honor to have you today. Thank you so much for joining me, and welcome to Women of Truth.
Thank you so much, Helenique, for such an amazing introduction. And I still recall the way we met, and I feel that it was a destiny. And there we are again working together. I really love the rapport that we have built over time, and really love the way we collaborate on these. We continue to collaborate on these projects. Indeed. So thank you so much for the prerogative of inviting me here and being here with you today.
Thank you so much. And as we've known each other, I've seen you kind of graduate, get promoted literally in your company into a higher level of responsibility. And I've noticed over the months also your very passionate and devoted style. And I really thought it would be great to share that with women in our group and in our network, because learning from women like yourself is always valuable. We are always learning from each other, no matter who we are. But also, I think you have very specific skills that are being recognized and taking you into more decision power in the work you do. So I think it's great for women out there listening now to know that you have senior roles and you have had in managing global teams, and you've been responsible for various aspects of recruitment, organizational design, employee management, talent management, leadership development, really helping employees relate better to each other, working with conflict resolution, changing initiatives, succession planning, diversity and inclusion, coaching and mentoring. And of course, it's so valuable to meet you as a woman also in Pakistan. I know that this has been probably a very unique journey that you have taken in your life, and we'd like to know more about it. So tell us, what was one of the most, let's say, life-changing experiences you've had in your life, and what did it teach you?
Thank you so much for asking. Amazing question. This is something which I presented when I was there in Cairo too, something very close to my heart. So why I ended up in this journey is, like I said, a great question. This goes back to the time when I was in grade 10, and I so much wanted to be a leader, and becoming a head girl of the school meant something. Like, it was to come in the spotlight, someone who is having the skill set and the talent to manage that position. It was considered to be a position of authority, and that, you know, really meant something for me. A, because I was a position holder throughout my school, within my, you know, like beginning from class prep until class 9th. And then secondly, I believed that I also was a monitor. I was always appointed as a monitor in every grade, in every class. But to my surprise, when I was in grade 10th, and when I opted to be a leader, I was told by my class teacher that, Samia, you are not good enough. You should not do that. You're a very hardworking individual, and you should rather invest your time in education and in your studies. And so I had a question, like, it was my natural ability to ask questions. I was very inquisitive. I had probably that curiosity that why not me? Like, you know, what is it that is stopping me? And the response that I got was that, because, you know, you are a girl, and this is meant to be rather for boys to be great leaders. And that turned me off like anything. It was like, you cannot even imagine, Helenique, the impact of this sentence on me, on my life, and the journey where I am. But I'm happy that I have, you know, I had gone through that time. It took me a couple of days. I went back home. I asked my mom that, you know, why is it like, am I lacking something? Is this something I'm not doing good enough? Is it that people consider that boys are far better than how women are? And so my mom was very kind enough. She had like, you know, three daughters and coming and working, like living in Pakistan. It's not that easy. But I had never, you know, come across that discrimination at home while I had three elder sisters and me being the fourth one. In Pakistan, it's very different. Like a woman would want to have a male child rather than a female one. But I was very fortunate. Both my parents, they were very supportive of me. I was like the youngest one because my parents weren't expecting me. And after a long, long time, they made that decision because the society was putting a lot of pressure. So that was the turning moment of my life where I thought that, okay, if this is life, then I'll prove myself. I have to do something different. I have to do something unique. Even if that requires me to have more education than men, I'll go for it. I have to be something. And I never wanted to be labeled as someone just because I'm a woman. But then over a period of time, and I was fortunate to also come across numerous opportunities, even having this interview with you, I feel that it is also a great opportunity that I am grabbing right now. I'm someone who believes that, you know, this life is limitless. Like, you know, your strengths are limitless. You as a human being, you are unique. You can bring so much that has to be acknowledged. So I just want to leave a legacy behind me, even if I die. And of course, I have to die because I have a time that I have to spend here in life.
Fantastic. So there's such a strong conviction in you always when we share and we speak about what you know to be true. And so I'm wondering, in that moment where she said that to you, and, you know, as you worked through it, knowing that you weren't going to receive the same kind of discrimination at home as you did at school, and subsequent years showing you more about life, what did you learn about that challenge? What did you learn from going through that experience?
So it's a great question. Just to add to it, like at home, I didn't come across that discrimination. That's right. My parents like raised me very differently. While it was a true or it was a fact, but I hadn't experienced it at my home. That's why it was a question for my mom, that why is it different? That was the first time when I came across this realization that that's how women are seen. And so what made, you know, what steps I took, I would say is, I recall my first decision, and that decision led me to making numerous other decisions, which is why I feel that I probably, this is one of my strengths where I'm good at making decisions. And that was the first time. So I recall my first decision was that, you know, my three siblings, all of them are like, you know, they're doing a great jobs, and I belong to a family of doctors, and MBBS was considered to be the right thing for women at my home. And that is also like, if you are from Asia, is usually, you know, you have two choices. It will be either engineering or, you know, MBBS, but things are gradually changing here as well for the younger generation. It's no longer the same thing, but earlier back in the time that I'm talking about or that I belong to, that was a similar thing. So I still recall that computer sciences was very new. And so my first decision was around not going through and not having science as a subject, and rather, you know, having computer sciences as a subject for my future. So it was a very tough decision. I knew if I'm going to talk about it to my parents, they may not like it. They may not acknowledge this decision. However, I brought courage. I thought about it. I went up to the mirror. I practiced, you know, how am I going to talk about it with my parents? It was a hard talk, first ever hard talk that I was willing to have with them. Because honestly, to me, it never made any sense, Helenique, to memorize frog and, you know, the digestive system of frog or so many systems. I kept questioning myself that, Samia, what are you going to do, right? If you are going to learn it, even if you learn it, like, you know, you would not love it. So what I did was I went ahead, I spoke with my mom that, say, I'm not interested, I can't do this. And she told me, see, you have to think over it. It is not that simple of a decision. None of my children ever came up to me making the statement or saying that they're not going to have this science. So I'm probably not willing, but still I'll give you some time. I took my time of 3 days since it was given to me. I came back and I said, I'm very strong about my decision. And my mom was like, okay, fair enough. If this is your decision, then you have to live with it as well. You have to own it. Like, you don't have to come to me at a later point in time and say that this was not the right decision and I probably have to repeat the year again. And every day, you know, you literally, I would pray to God that I should not come in an awkward spot where, you know, this confidence that I had gathered and the way I had that conversation. So eventually, you know, I never wanted it to be backfired. And so I was super happy and I would, you know, do certain things. I would meet with my teacher. When I made that decision, Hellenic, and so my mom's even, you know, reassurance about the fact that, okay, I'll support you in your decision, but then you have to own it. That led me to making numerous decisions within my life. And I'm someone who is a very strong advocate of the fact that you just don't make those decisions. See, decisions can be right. They can be wrong. They can be average. What brings life to those decisions is your conviction and the way you own it, whether good or bad, how you learn from those mistakes, even if you make mistakes, because everybody makes mistakes. I have made, and I'm very proud to even, you know, own those mistakes. The other day I was delivering a session to 125 employees in another company where they wanted me to talk about my career growth and the journey I have had and what are the rules. While I was talking about success rules, I made it a point that, you know, remembering your mistakes and learning from those mistakes and talking about that mistakes is also super imperative, because that has made me who I am. And without those mistakes, I wouldn't have been here. And I don't even repent or regret about any of the decisions that I have made over the period of time. Because whosoever I am is because of all those decisions, the things that I probably considered or I continue doing with persistence and is where I am. So I don't want to, number one, change anything about myself or my journey. And two is that I am a better version of myself because I look at and reflect on those mistakes every day. Yeah. That's how I feel.
So it's a few things inside what you're sharing. The first sounds like a very important moment where you realize that the outside world and school and teachers' opinions of girls are quite different to what you're getting at home. And the second is something about really learning how you need to be responsible for what you decide. And you learned that very young from your mother and from that moment, choosing computer science and not to follow the family and the whole trend of what would normally be chosen as science. So it gave you a very strong kind of conviction and certainty about learning from mistakes, being responsible, no matter what the decision is, that you give life to that decision by actually really just living it and being responsible and knowing that if you make mistakes, you learn from that as well too. So if we go back to that 8-year-old, even younger than the age you were when you were opting for that position to lead at school, and you know what you know now as an adult person, looking back at, let's say, your 8-year-old little girl, Samia, that was ready for the world, she didn't have that encounter with the teacher, she then didn't end up working at SNG Global yet, and she's still in the world, and wanting the world and her future to be obviously wonderful and really looking forward to all those moments. And knowing what you know now as this wise older woman, you're quite a traveler, you've been to so many events, you address great groups of people often. What advice would you give her?
I will give her a couple of advices. If there is one, then let me know. I'll stick to one. However, if there is a room to share two, three. Okay. One would be not to invest time, Samia, in things which are your area or within the area of concern, because that is not going to help you anywhere. So if you have to invest time, then rather invest your time in how you can make an influence, how you can do certain things about it. But investing time where there is no control, as an example, why someone said something to you, how someone has perceived you, how did you come across someone, like, this should not be part of your book or dictionary at all. You should rather say that what I can do to make sure that people see you differently, how you are adding value in any conversation or in any project that you are working on or any organization that you are going to work with. So rather, you know, invest your energies very wisely, be resourceful, but in the right things and the right and in a very effective and right manner, rather than talking or thinking invest. That this will be my advice number one. my advice number two would be that you should never think, Samia, that, you know, your dreams are smaller than this world. So your dreams have to be bigger and fierce. The reason is the more bigger your dreams are, and nobody can stop you from having those dreams because they are your dreams. Because, you know, you have seen those dreams, and so you should make every effort to make those dreams possible, because this life is given to you only once. There is no point that you sit back, again, invest your time thinking about, you know, that this is not possible and this cannot be done. Everything is possible as long as you have the conviction, as long as you know the rules of the game, and as long as you are persistent about achieving them. So dream big. The bigger your dreams are, the more energy you will have in life in order to fulfill your dreams. That will be my advice number two. And my advice number three would be that do not judge people, because you don't know what is their journey. Sometimes, you know, there are times when you get to feel that, okay, somebody spoke to me, this is how I felt, fair enough, but move on. Give room to others, because you don't know what they are going through. And likewise, just forgive them in life. The more you forgive, and the more you give as well. Like, you know, if you can help someone, continue helping. Don't think why you helped, regardless if somebody has treated you badly, because the more you give is the more content you become in your life, and forgive if somebody has done something to you. So these are my life rules, as much as I feel and believe. So I think these are three things I would have told the younger Samia.
Yeah, you know, this beautiful phrase comes out when you speak. I've heard you say it a few times. Give people room. I think it's very important, and it's taken me a really long time in my life to learn that. And because I analyze a lot of what goes on, it's often a conclusion to understanding. So many things influence most of what we do. So the more room you give people, the more you don't take it personally what they're doing or saying or thinking about you and everything else. It's got to do with them. You just give them more and more space. I love that. I think it's really powerful. So we move now to one of the best questions for the interview, which is really the reason I started these, was to try and understand the way that women are misled and or misleading themselves. And so I asked this question like this: what do you think is the biggest lie that women believe, and what is the truth?
The biggest lie that women believe is that they do not have any voice. And that, you know, the other gender has to understand their silence. And that, you know, because they think that they are different, is their thinking or their idea that others have to invest time in terms of, you know, helping them or give, like, sharing that or shifting the responsibility, that the male gender has to understand them, is the biggest lie, how I see. Because it is our opportunity. If we belong to a minority group, and if we feel that, you know, we come across discrimination in so many different patterns, which is the truth, it is our space to go ahead and make sure to turn around things. We cannot give that responsibility to someone else. It should be within our control. It has to be within our power. And we should do right things to make sure that we have voice, even if somebody is not giving us voice. Or if somebody is, you know, not giving us a seat at the table. So it is our opportunity.
Yeah. So we believe, or we can tend to believe, that we don't have a voice. And the truth is that we do have a voice. And it's our responsibility to speak up.
Absolutely.
That solves so many problems. Let me just reassure everybody listening that we've heard so many different ways where we can empower. This word is being almost overused. So I think it's such a great way to fix a lot of that problem, is to realize, again, it's about your own responsibility and your own decisions that then you make. If you choose to stay silent, that's your decision. So Samia, tell me, how do you make that work in male-female relationships?
It's love, a wonderful question.
Love relationships. That's why I'm asking you. I'm going a little off track here. To get a little
relationships with everyone, or relationships with the male gender?
with male gender and let's say specific intimate relationships, like how you equal yourself in a relationship as opposed to buying into being the victim or being silenced or being, you know, not unable to really speak what you feel.
Very nice. So what works for me, Helenique, is number one, I always do research. So when I, for example, if I'm meeting someone for the very first time, I will do the research on my own through LinkedIn. That is the greatest tool that helps me, at least, who the individual is, what the individual will like me to talk about, how, if you know, there are any differences, it will at least give me some idea that what's the background and what are some of the common things that I can begin my conversation with to build my rapport. That is one of it. The second would be that, you know, if I know someone very well as a colleague, as an example, and I will know that, you know, what's going to be his thought process and what's going to be mine. And if I have to implement change or bring change or talk about change, then what I usually do is that I'll set up some time with the person in private rather than socializing the whole idea in front of so many other folks and, you know, talking about it or sharing disagreements in front of everyone, because when we talk about everyone or in front of everyone, then there is a tendency that we get to offend people. So I would rather disagree in private than disagree in public. That has worked for me, and it is something which continues to work for me when I'm speaking with another gender. And I'm very open about my disagreements, but those are one-on-one. Yeah. I give some time to people when they're able to get them absorbed. Then we talk about it again. I resume back the conversation. And so this is how, you know, slowly and gradually that works for me. These are two things which I, you know, very, in a very, I would say, consistent manner I do, and these things really work for me. Do you want more or is it fine that, you know, we stick to these two?
I think that's great. It's a nice process for us to just imagine how you apply what you've said. So, you know, we met at this Women Economic Forum, and there's so many of these organizations meeting around the world of women, talking so much about women being more visible. And I really wanted to know what you think about the movement of all these women's events, organizations, associations, and if there's anything that you would add to it or you would like to be getting out of it that you're not, or anything you'd like to say about it.
I will say I really love this idea. Number one, to have these forums, to have these events, to let women know that these platforms are there. And honestly, for me, it was the first time to be part of this event, and it has paid me off big time. It is benefiting me a lot. Now, if your question natural would be that how is it benefiting you? So one is the support that I feel, that I'm not alone in this journey. I have so many other women and they're going through similar things. And this reassurance, you know, gives me a lot of confidence that it's not just me. Earlier, I would have this sense that, you know, why is it me? Am I going through this? Now I really feel that there are so many other women, including, like, you know, you are one example. We all are. There are so many other women that I've met and I continue to have them in my network. And when I talk to you, I feel so good. I have that spirit. I have that energy. Second, I would say is, that definitely, because otherwise also, like, you get to have those opportunities. If you are passionate about a project, and if I can, in any possible way, if I can support you, then that gives me another avenue to work together. Likewise, you know, if I have something and if you can help me, like, you know, you build those allies, and these allies help you a lot in the longer term. Third, I would say that this has, you know, like, having this session attended at Egypt, this, on top of having a course that I had attended through Stanford Graduate School of Business, which was Power to Lead. And so these are the tips which are being recommended to women all the time. And one is, number one, build your personal brand. Second is to be visible and show that what do you do or how you are doing things or what you should be known for. It gives you not only a brand equity that you build, but this is how, you know, you become someone for whom even employers will be willing to go above and beyond in terms of compensating you. And then in today's world, especially with a lot of evolution going on, if your presence is not there on the digital media or social media, nobody will ever know what you are doing, regardless of the fact that I've seen so many women doing phenomenal work. But just because they don't know how to promote it, what to say, how to present it, they end up losing opportunities in comparison with men. However, you know, when I started doing it, I'll be very honest, Helenique, I started, you know, building my personal brand and then presenting it and being visible since 2019. And it's only 1.5 year, beginning from January 2019. It's just 1.5 year that I feel that I'm opening, doors to numerous opportunities, which I wasn't even aware of. Like just now, before I was having a session with you, and I met, I don't know the guy, but he reached out to me through LinkedIn and he wanted me to be part of the summit, which is happening on June 13th. And I was just, you know, recording my 20 seconds video for him because he wants it to be there. Now, how am I doing it? So for me, the tool is social media, but again, visibility is something very important. We should not shy away from being visible and for being open about our branding. It is a problem for women. I have gone through it. I was always camera shy. I feel I still am. I don't know whether, you know, that is visible to you or not, but I have tried to overcome.
I love that you touch on that because I think it's a very underrated benefit of being so connected and being able to have this international exposure is becoming more important than ever for very specific women, maybe not all of them, but certainly these opportunities are presented in many different ways through the women's movement. And I think I've also started to see how important it really is in order to move global change forward. So not just for an individual business or an individual employer to see your value, or maybe even just for your own kind of fame and glamour, which a lot of people misunderstand it to be about. I think it's definitely possible to accept this incredible opportunity to develop your personal branding in order to actually really have more impact. And I think it's really possible that the women's movement is, well, adding that to its repertoire of opportunities that is definitely being experienced by many people now. So I'm glad we touched on it. And now I want to know a bit more about you, your passion, what you're busy with now that's bringing you a lot of energy and joy. What are you working on at the moment? And what can people reach out to you for or with if they want to get to know you a bit more?
So first off, I'm a very, very passionate human resources professional. Having an experience of 13 years, I continue to give back to my profession now through multiple projects that I continue to work with the Society for Human Resource Management. That is one. Another is my objective that I have set for this year. I'm a Global Goodwill Ambassador for Pakistan. So my objective is to combat child abuse. For that, I have the content that was created by Chrissy Sykes. And the idea is to have it socialized with different institutions. It's a global content. It is being utilized by different countries. So if there is any interest, if somebody would love to have it, so there are, you know, multiple poems, and through those poems, you socialize this idea that what is the good touch, what is the bad touch, how children need to be more aware of the good touch versus the bad touch, and they have to report to their loved ones as and when they feel and that's not the right way of being treated. So that is my very... that's my biggest passion, that I have to do it until the end of this year. I have to socialize that. Thirdly, I would say is I have this assigned objective, and nobody has set these objectives, and these are my personal objectives. I continue to set them every year. So the third one is where I would want to develop people in whatever capacity I can. So anyone who is within this field of human resources or otherwise as well, if somebody thinks that I can be of any value, if somebody wants to learn how to write an article or what is it about the diversity and inclusion or how to mentor a junior colleague, or these are like those areas where I can easily help any area regarding the human resources, I'll be more than happy to be of help. Yeah. And so what I'm busy with, one is this digital symposium, which I just spoke about, which is going to happen on June 13th. I'll be presenting. It's University of South Asia, Lahore. They want to promote the education within Pakistan. So that is one. And then the second one is where I was told to lead a session for the Stanford Graduate School of Business, which is happening next month. And the idea is to share my learnings and my experiences during that 1 year lead journey. So it was a leadership development program. What I have learned, what I was doing, things that worked out for me. So I'm going to lead that session for rest of the leaders there. I'm very passionate about it. I'm just trying to think that what I can do or how, or what are some of the things that I'll be presenting. I'm thinking about the content designing too. So that is the second project, which right now I'm very passionate about. These are my short term, I'd say rather more of short term, whereas, you know, I've also mentioned about my year's plan. I haven't created the plan for the next year. So probably next year will be the good time or the year end to get to know what I'll be busy with.
Wonderful. So when you speak about being able to take on some smaller projects with people that are interested in HR, is that as a freelancer or as a mentor, or are you looking at, do you do consulting separately? How does that work?
So it's a wonderful question, I must say, Helenique. Basically, these are those projects that are created by Society for Human Resource Management, and they give that opportunity to people. So I kind of volunteer for their projects. Like I'm also giving back. I'm making that contribution. They're not the projects that I'm owning or I'm leading, but rather I'm just investing my time to help my profession for the future. If you want an example, I'll give you an example. Basically, like, you know, there is a project to look at the content and see if there is any bias that we can mitigate. Those projects are available with them. It's just that you have to, you know, raise your hand and just volunteer. So that is what I'm doing in my capacity. I'm just contributing, okay. Not leading.
Got it. Great. So if people reach out to you or are interested more in getting to know you, they can find you on the LinkedIn profile, Samia Kamar. You spell it Q-A-M-A-R, and you'll see it on this video. And the last tradition we have on closing this interview, Samia, is to actually ask you for three words. They're either connected or they're separate words, and they give us a chance to know what you deem to be really important. So what would your three words be that capture your wisdom, your knowledge, your importance, your values, maybe whatever you like, for everyone watching to remember you by?
So Helenique, do you want it as an advice, or do you want that those three words should be associated with me, or how people should be viewing me, or is it the three words that, you know, I will share so that people consider that it is of paramount importance? Like, if you can elaborate.
Yeah, the last one. So you choose three words that are really important for you and that others can capture, as you will explain to them as well with me here now, what is the reason you choose these words and why are they so important?
I will say personal brand, mm-hmm, is one.
Great.
Two would be integrity and credibility.
Right.
Third would be hard work and then having a voice at the table. Always having a voice, never to be silent, never to kill your voice. If you have to say that, say it in one word, I'll say always have a voice and always try to have a seat at the table, even if somebody's not giving you.
Excellent. So you've got all that, I hope, everybody watching. The first one was about
personal brand.
Branding, right. Really being unafraid of stepping into that visibility and how important it really is to promote and present what you do. You can be doing great work, but unless you are presenting it or promoting it, no one knows about it. And yeah, it maybe is not always necessary for everyone out there, but I think for vast majority nowadays, this is something we have to become very comfortable about. So personal branding. Second one was all about being, I normally remember them really well. It's a Saturday. We're recording these on a lazy day. So maybe that's why I'm a bit like, my brain's gone a little bit lazy. So the
integrity, credibility.
Credibility and integrity, so important. It's part of our Women of Truth formula. So we've got integrity and credibility, because how you stand and how you are with your branding and your personal exposure to the world has to hold something of your ethics. I think it's very important. And the third one was about having a voice and making sure that you have a place at the table, whether you're given one or not. And if we were to sum it all up and say, what's the most important out of all three that Samia is talking about, it's really making sure that you do not suppress your voice, that you are very present and in your truth about what it is you're here to say and do. Thank you so much, Samia. It's been lovely chatting to you.
And likewise, Helenique.
Yeah, lovely getting to know you. And thank you to everybody watching. It's been great to share all this with you. And you remember now that you have someone in HR to look up to have as a spearhead for the profession moving forward. So for all of you out there that are in businesses, this is what it looks like to have someone on your team that's really forward thinking and really concerned about making sure all the HR needs are met. And of course, you also heard it from Samia that really taking a step into meeting up on a global platform with different women can do a lot for your movement forward into your personal brand. So thanks again, Samia. Lovely spending time. Take care.
Thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody.